Pillow number 11, significance and acceptance. And, you know, I famously talk about this during our main presentation when we talk about hopelessness with kids and the destructive decisions they make, and we say why. Why would more 10 to 14-year-olds be ending their own life or making other destructive decisions than ever before in history? And you say, well, it's this contagion called hopelessness that we talk so much about. And you say, what leads a kid to hopelessness? And if you look at the reason why 22 service members take their own life every day in this country, you can trace it back to the fact that they have lost some kind of meaning or significance or purpose in their life. It's changed, like, from everything they've known. We know that from our buddy Rick Yarish, who, in the blink of an eye, his meaning was changed. But number two, it's this human acceptance that all kids crave. And so those are two very distinct things. Like, you asked Jason a little while ago, you're like, how do you connect with a kid? Well, it's easy for me. I just find out what they find significant, what kind of meaning they're searching for, and I make that connection. Not my meaning, not my significance. That, you know, is the youth sports motto, where dads are trying to find meaning in their son or their daughter's sport. You got to allow them to develop their own meaning, and you got to recognize that in a young person. So we take a lot of time and effort to have teachers understand and put in their tool belt that you want to really truly help a kid grow their meaning, their significance, their purpose, help them with that. They certainly have to do the work themselves, but recognize it. And the other thing is acceptance. And sometimes people say, well, how do you just make a kid accept another kid? Well, I jump way back to another pillow and say, you got to model that. I mean, when was the last time they saw you talk to this other teacher that they know you detest? Like, have they seen you do that? Have they seen you surrender and take a knee? Probably not. I just know with my own kids, if I want my kids to start accepting people that are different, they got to see me accept kids that are different. So Jason's really been a master at especially getting kids to accept other kids, and sometimes head faking them a little bit. But he's got, you know, brilliant story about a young man a couple years ago that knew was searching for meaning and acceptance and was going to have a tough time figuring that out.
Yeah, if there's ever a story that involves multiple pillows from the 13 pillows, this would be one of them. And this was probably one of the most stressful, like, 3 days I had had in a while. And it was, I want to say 3 years ago now. And what it was I got my first transgender student. And it was and I'm a phys ed teacher, right? Locker rooms are a big deal. I think we've come a long way, and people have more protocols in place and comfort around locker rooms and bathrooms and all gender. This was, you know, like 3 or 4 years ago. And I was, like, stressed out because you see stuff in the media and you just, you know, well, I can have a transgender student. What is that? What's okay? What's not okay? Nobody ever really told me where the laws were and so on. And we're talking about changing in middle school, right? So I have, this was a sixth grade biological female identifying as a transgender male as a seventh grade. And a lot of these kids had elementary years with this student. And the student's name kind of fit male and female roles. But so this student came to school early, a day early, to meet with me and the guidance counselor and the mom. And we had some great conversation. And I reframed after 2 or 3 days of stress right before the meeting. I said, I'm going to make this amazing. I probably stole it from him. That's what he always says to me when I complain about something. But I said, I'm going to make this amazing. This is going to be one of the most powerful professional development opportunities I've ever had. I get my first transgender student. Yes. So I walked down to the guidance office and had the meeting, and I listened to the mother say the wrong pronoun. And that gave me, like, this feeling of, like, oh, phew. If that happens, it'll be okay. I'll live through it, because even the mom is making that mistake. Understandably, as you start to really wrap your brain around it. So anyway, I took this student and said, look, changing, not changing, whatever you want to do. I don't believe in making kids change. I recommend it for different issues and or different reasons related to certain issues that can happen in a phys ed setting. But it's up to the student, and or just wear clothes that you want to wear that are comfortable on a phys ed day, whatever. So I said, you know, changing isn't going to be an issue. But what I didn't even know we do, I wasn't even thinking about it. I just became more aware was boy on day four of phys ed, which is week two, because you have Monday, Wednesday, Friday, then you have Tuesday, Thursday. Day four, we boys got the green cards and girls got the pink. That was like, I didn't even think about that.
What,
right?
Are pink cards and green
so
cards?
So they were attendance cards. It's just a system that we have in place. So we separate by gender. Mm. I mean, so.
Time, you know, to update that.
Yeah, a little old school, right? Mm. So I was like, oh my God, I didn't realize, you know, this is our first transgender student in the school. So I said, you don't even have to have a card if you don't want. I said, or you can take a green card. It's up to you. But none of the other students knew. They, you know, only place that really matters in a middle school, whether you're a boy or girl, is gym class at that time, right? So there was going to be this kind of like coming out for this student, because when we separated male, female, we were, the females were going to, the girls were going to go to soccer, and boys were going to do flag football. I had to prepare the class for this, and it was going to be like, whoa, because they didn't know it was coming. And no one knew. Even some of the students' friends didn't know, close friends. So I had that responsibility, and I gave a little mini speech at the beginning of that class, because here's my class. All the girls went outside. Here's that student on the edge of the bleacher. And I said, hey, you know, we have a transgender student. I said, I'm excited. I've never had a transgender student before. I said, maybe some of you haven't experienced it. I said, but I can't wait. I said, I'm going to learn a lot, and pretty interesting to me. I said, you don't have to agree with it. You don't have to like it, but we will respect it, and we'll make sure that every student has dignity in this environment. So we...
How did the students respond?
Well, I gave that speech, and then I was like, okay, action, and started class. So I didn't give them a chance to respond. I just set the stage, went out, and I made sure that that student was in a group on the field, because we separated into three different small-sided groups, and did some lead-up stuff. And I made sure that student was in a good space. And then during the class, I was fortunate. This probably wouldn't have happened if this kid wasn't injured, but I had an injured student who happened to be one of my top students and very respectful kid. And I confided in him. I said, hey, I was terrified to have to share that. His father was a teacher in the high school. So I just said, you know, that this is my first transgender student. I said, did I blow your mind with that speech? And he goes, I think so-and-so, the kid's name is Brave. And I said, really? I said, that's powerful, man. I said, really? This kid's name was Cameron. He said, so-and-so's Brave. I said, would you say that in front of the other guys? I said, that would be huge, because if you show that you're accepting and, you know, respectful of it, I said, they'll really be influenced by you. He said, yeah, no. I said, you sure? I said, I want to put you out there and make you feel. He goes, no, I'm fine with it. So at the end of class, I gave some closure, talked about the next class, and I said, oh, and by the way, so the very last thing that they left off on, I said, I wanted you to know that, you know, I mentioned I'm really excited about having the student in class, never had a transgender student. I said, I asked Cameron while we were standing here watching class what he thought. And Cameron, what'd you say? And he said, I think it's Brave. And when I applied that to the significance and acceptance, I got one of the alpha males, one of the pack leaders, because middle school kids especially fit the bill. We're all pack animals. And middle school kids especially are looking for that pack. I got the pack leader to accept the, you know, weirdest one of the bunch, the most unique, most different one of the, and, you know, they're kind of looking at this student thinking, what do we do? And if one kid is unaccepting or disrespectful, or the pack could go that direction easily. So for me, my strategy for transitioning this student successfully was to get one of the alpha males, alpha leaders, to accept this unique, different student. And it proved to be pretty powerful. It was never an issue. I mean, weeks later, he was coming into the transgender student. He was coming into the locker room and having conversations with me. This student's in high school now, having a really successful experience in the high school. So
I'm curious, and maybe you cut this part out, but before you gave that speech to the PE class where you described it as a coming out, did you ask permission from the trans student if you could
help
them like that?
Yeah, okay. We had a lot of conversation on what it would look like. We had that meeting before school even started, of, you know, so I knew that none of his friends knew. I knew even some of close friends, because you go to science class, it doesn't matter how you identify, really. There's no conversation. It's just assumed, you know, you've always been you, you're you, and I'm me. And but when we had to go boy and girl separate.
So has the school updated their practices and creating all those binary scenarios?
Yeah, the card system is different. Yeah, definitely. But there's, you know, the one of the things that's really challenging to get around, and one of the things I say when I present to audiences as far away as Atlanta and
boys
audience,
and girls.
Well, I'm talking about the teachers. Mm-hmm. I don't have to agree with it. I just have to provide a space where it's a respected environment, where kids are accepting of other kids, and it's a space where there's hope and action for others. So, you know, but I do believe that a male-female separation in seventh grade, mm-hmm. during some units is important. Now, that could be old-fashioned, mm-hmm. and it certainly doesn't fit all situations.
Well, you have to think about the what we're used to, and the way we've understood the world is it's one or the other. And more kids are able to communicate that they are not at one end of the
right
of it or the other. So I think that maybe along with swear words is kind of going out the window, because kids are able to communicate that they aren't one or the other necessarily.
Again, not to build on top of what Jason is saying, like, because I deal with this issue because I go into schools and talk, and I'm not in his shoes. But you know, my position is it really doesn't matter at this point what you believe, or whether that's a true statement that you made about one end or the other. But that kid, regardless, has the right to dignity and worth, mm-hmm. and that's the important part.
Some things that I became sort of clued in on in my own practice over the years is, you know, I taught history for a long time, so we would do like Jeopardy at the end of a unit before there was some kind of assessment. Separate, like boys versus girls. And I love the idea of battle of the sexes. And the more trans students we've had in our school that I've gotten to know, I've just realized little by little what a binary experience they are in all of these ways we don't even really think through. Like, we'll have picture day. It'll take a day to get everyone's photo taken. And the secretary will say, okay, 10th grade boys through A through D, come down. So we've been trying to be more self-aware of the way that we have created these binary experiences that are like really transphobic and make someone who does identify as trans makes their experience difficult. So I think we should do everything we can to make that experience as positive as possible.
It's definitely, you know, one of the things that I say, it's never been harder in human history to be a teacher.
Oh, no question.
It's never been harder to be a parent, but what we have to remember, it's never been harder to be a kid, mm-hmm. because they're the ones who are kids. You know, they're the yep. ones with the unformed brain. So it really, the responsibility falls on us to do some of the hard work of questioning everything.
Mm-hmm. You know, just to kind of wrap up this, and we spent a tremendous amount of time on acceptance, because one of the biggest issues is this whole pack mentality. I mean, they're pack animals. They care what their friends think. They care what other people are going to say. You can't change that. John Medina talks about this program that runs in the teenage brain that drives it away from its pack that it cares about for the first 10 years of its life, and it searches for a new pack. And you can't stop that program from running. But one of the things that I always pause and come back to is, don't forget the significance part of this pillow. And kids are in a deep search, like every human is, for meaning or purpose or significance in their life. And some kids that find themselves in very dark places are the kids that don't have very much meaning, or they feel like they don't. So I think that as an educator, this pillow that you can fail on a lot is you didn't really grow that kid's meaning, their purpose, their significance. Like, you might think that, you know, playing cards is stupid, but this kid has a love for playing cards, you know. So how do you grow that significance in that individual and not say, no, this is what you have to do? It's just easy to do as an adult, mm-hmm. to a kid, to say, oh, that's stupid, you should do this over here instead. And really growing their meaning, their significance, is a huge part of this pillow.
Yeah, I transitioned. I mentioned the young lady earlier who in my peak performance class in the high school really had a hard time with some of the movements. And eventually grew into doing the workout in its entirety and being comfortable enough to do it. Maybe not loving it, but the strategy of using significance and acceptance, you know, her thing was music. So she was like our DJ for like 3 months. Mm-hmm. She didn't work out. She just picked the songs. And man, did she feel important and accepted when she played one of her, you know, she happened to like pretty intense heavy metal, hard headbanging stuff. And she, you know, she would identify herself as an emo, an emotional kid. And she found significance there, and that was the way I won her over. And I think that strategically, I align that pillar with Maslow's hierarchy of needs. And that's the Maslow had this psychological theory of human motivation, or and the hierarchy of needs, you know, speaks to the obvious food, shelter, water, physical safety, and then it goes into like the significance and acceptance. Really, acceptance first, belonging, community, love, intimacy, and then the next would be your purpose and your significance in the world and how you, that connects to your self-esteem. And then at the tip of it is to be to self-actualize, and that is your growth ability to have, you know, personal growth and reflection, and, you know, see your value in the world. And I think it's kind of funny how education and traditional teachers are contradicting Maslow's hierarchy of needs, because we know at home a lot of those needs for a large population of kids aren't being met, but we expect them to come right in and go to self-actualization in our subject area. But we're not meeting this, and I think we can't necessarily go follow them home and give them the love that they need, but we can give them significant doses of significance and acceptance, and then maybe get a little bit of that self-actualizing in the area of math or reading or phys ed. And I think that it's kind of funny that we want them to be high performers, but we're forgetting how important it is to give them those two next most important needs after food, shelter, and water, and that is acceptance and feeling significant. We need to work on that esteem.